Welcome to the third installment of my, what is apparently a fortnightly video drunken rant. I was in New York City on after last Thursday, and been in New York City in a long time, and it seemed weird, I don't know. Seasons, I felt like out of place. It reminded me of this movie. I should have looked up the specifics. It was called Zardoz. It was with Sean Connery. I don't know, it was probably made in the 70s or something, the 80s. The whole idea was that it was, post-apocalyptic or whatever, environment in the future where this elite group of people had set up their environment or their utopia, I guess you want to call it, of that they called the Vortex. I think they called it the Vortex, I believe. And so they, in order, for some strange reason, they were, so smart or whatever, they were immortal. But so the whole idea was this small group of people in the Vortex were going to make their lives, they were going to achieve, perfection, I guess, is what you would call it. But the rest of the world was dying all around them, and in order to keep the rest of the world from interfering in their world, they created this god they called Zardoz, which the movie's called Zardoz, and as it turns out, Zardoz is a takeoff on the Wizard of Oz. Zardoz. Sean Connery was one of the believers in Zardoz, and he was living out with all the, the people that weren't in the elite group, and they called him a brutal, and his job was to kill people, to population control, I guess, is for one thing, but then they didn't kill them all. They realized they had to keep some of them alive so they could farm for them, provide sustenance. So this stone head would fly around and give guns to the brutals so they could keep the rest of the people in line to either kill them or make them grow food. So what happens is Sean Connery is somehow enlightened. Apparently he read The Wizard of Oz or something like that, and he gets on to this vehicle. You have to see the movie, it's pretty funny. But so he comes to, he manages to get into the Vortex where the elite live. They want to kill him immediately, and I just felt like, the brutal, or the, when I went to New York, like fucking backward fuck, because it's just got this air of such elitism, and that the people that are, people that inhabit New York City are just so confident in their beliefs that they, they will guide us into, I guess utopia, maybe, I guess in the long run. I guess it's being a little presumptuous on my part, maybe. But, it does kind of make me think of how, the political system and works in this way that we think, it's kind of, so self-absorbed that they really think that they are trying to achieve a better life for everybody. And I don't really think that they are. I mean, I think that they are just so goddamn happy with their own lives that's the thing they want to keep. You know, they want to keep having special, you know, a life of privilege. You know, and you go to the city and there is this like level of, you know, very, very privileged people. And you see it, but you see all around all these, like, you know, people that are obviously struggling to get by, you know, all over the place. And they're like invisible almost, you know, they're like meaningless. And, you know, I don't know. It's just, you know, makes you think that, you know, makes you think that they really believe it, you know, that America has to lead the world into a better version of itself, that what they're doing, you know, and pretty much is just living like the fucking swell life, you know what I mean? You know, absorbed in their technology, you know, I mean, I sound like, you know, the old cranky old man, but, you know, I don't know what people are doing on their goddamn phones. I mean, I have a smartphone, and I just can't figure out, everybody is always just like, maybe I just have no, you know, life, I suppose, you know, everybody's just always, like, absorbed in their phone, like, flipping it around all the time. I just can't, what the fuck are they doing, man? I'm on the subway, I think, you know, I guess maybe if you're on the subway every day, you get bored with a lot of people, but whatever. I mean, I can't figure out why people can be so absorbed in their phones. I mean, you know, I guess it kind of goes back to this fucking movie. I mean, like, it's funny. I mean, what eventually happened, I think, it's kind of all kinds of strange stuff, but in the end, it's like it was like a crystal that reflected, you know, the image of the, you know, person looking into it. So it's just kind of like, I guess the point was, you know, they're just being very narcissistic and, like, you know, only looking at themselves and only caring about what was good for them, and not really caring what was good for everybody else. To try to achieve, you know, a very selfish version of utopia. And, you know, and I see that all the time where you hear your pundits and you know, on the left and the right, all of that, like, America is, you know, the leader in technology. We have to show, we have to advance civilization because we're the ones that know how to do it. You know, we see the future. But, you know, we're so busy looking at ourselves that we kind of ignore the fact that, you know, that we're shitting all over everybody. You know, I mean, I haven't talked yet about foreign policy, but, I mean, my God, you know, I mean, America is one of the most brutal, you know, warmongering countries, you know, in a long time. I mean, we're always engaged in war. You know, we kill people with drones, you know, children are dying all the time. We brutalize our own, stick with foreign policy. You know, we engage in wars. You know, kind of goes back to the Zardoz thing where, you know, we create this, you know, notion that, you know, that we're somehow godlike and that what we're trying to do is good for everybody by basically exploiting them and killing them. And the people that are, like, you know, benefiting by it, you know, are completely, oblivious to what, you know, what's really happening. And, you know, they don't see the blood on their hands. They don't see the killing that's done in their name. They don't see why they are, you know, able to be so privileged. And it's just arrogant as fuck, you know, I mean, and you know. You know, I don't want to be part of them. You know, I mean, that's fucking piece. I want to be the fucking brutal. I don't want to be part of their, you know, self-absorbed fucking world. I want to just live my life and just do what the fuck I want, you know. And I'm not like a person that's anti-technology. I mean, or anti, you know, as I talked last week, I'm not anti-capitalism. It's just this. It's the idea that it's becomes almost a religion. It becomes controlled, and you see this in debates about is religion a force for good, or is, you know, science a force for good? I saw Richard Dawkins talking about at Oxford recently. And he's a fucking tool, man. I mean, like, you know, there, you know, this, the dude's asking him, well, religion's good, and isn't it? And they have these kind of like false comparisons between, you know, religion and religious, evil, where, you know, people are fighting over religious things, but then all, you know, Mao and Stalin killed people. But, you know, it's not religion, it's exploitation. I mean, you can't fucking exploit people and say, you know, we're doing it for God, or we're doing it for fucking science. You're fucking doing it for yourself, you motherfucker. You know, and that's what we are. I mean, we pretend like we're, you know, engaged in this endeavor to make the world better. And we're engaged generally in an endeavor to enrich ourselves and have this fucking cushy life. You know, have a fucking cushy life, but please recognize that you're exploiting people. You're killing people. You're taking advantage of people. They even go so far as, like, some of these crazy fuckers, like, that, like, try to blame, you know, overpopulation. Well, you know, maybe overpopulation is a bad thing, but, you know, the implication is always, oh, we should kill some motherfuckers so, you know, so we could have a better life. Well, at least you get rid of, like, the people that don't deserve to live, you know? Or we should choose who's entitled to have a good life. And behind that philosophy is this notion, you know, again, to the American philosophy of, well, we have to guide the world to become, you know, like us. But we're shitheads, you know. I mean, if we really wanted to, you know, bring the world into a better place, we would try to, like, you know, bring up everybody around, you know, because there might be an Einstein that's in the fucking ghetto, or if we were more able to see the other side of the, you know, the other side of the coin more often, you know, we would maybe be a little bit more enlightened. So it's just this such a fucking, you know. I mean, people aren't bad people. They just can't conceive that their way of doing things, or their way of thinking, could possibly be wrong. You know, I mean, and they just have such fucking small minds. You know, I mean, I was watching on the news about this, like, fucking cover on the Rolling Stone. Jesus Christ. You know, it has this kid that, like, you know, was a terrorist. Well, you know, maybe we should ask ourselves how a fucking good-looking kid becomes a terrorist, you know? I mean, it goes back. We had no problem. You know, when we were looking at the, you know, guys who committed genocide and the Holocaust in Germany, and saying, you know, well, these are normal people, you know, Hannah Arendt was, you know, talking about the banality of evil and how it just comes out of normal places. And where does it come from? You know, but, you know, we don't want to look at it. You know, we don't want to even think that maybe that somehow our arrogance and our inability to kind of look deeper into what's going on in the world and what's going on around us somehow sows the seeds of this fucking hatred. And we can't conceive that because we're so goddamn good. You know, we're so fucking good, you know? And see people like fucking, you know, goddamn Hitler on Time Magazine. You know, just so silly, and it just kind of like just felt like a, you know, I don't know, like walking around New York City, just like seeing you know how self satisfied people seem to be, you know, and like, you know, I guess it's probably not just New York City, but that you know, I think, you know, you can't be so goddamn happy, man. You gotta like do a little soul searching and ask yourself, do I deserve to be where I am? You know, but I don't see a lot of that happening. So it was just kind of strange, you know. I don't know. I just felt very out of place, man. Anyhow, well, yeah, wait, I can't leave without mentioning Glenn Greenwald, now known as Gren. And because I was so goddamn drunk last time, I wasn't that drunk, but he's forgetful. The reason I was saying we should call him Gren is because he's become such a, like, superstar of the news media among the progressives and everybody. Thinks Snowden is such a great guy. But I think, you know, he's achieved the single name status, like Bono, you know, or some of those other people. Bono's the only one I can think of. But on the Snowden thing, I really, you know, I think Snowden should just suck it up and come back, man. Take his fucking licks. And, you know, maybe people then, they won't, because the media won't cover it, of course, but. But it's going to be, you know, maybe it might help Bradley Manning out or something. I guess he blocks. That's an absurd fucking another case that nobody watches, you know. But you know, life is good, so who the fuck needs a watch?